First Timothy, united in a common purpose. Paul describes Timothy as a true son of the faith, which is such a marvelous testimony of the character of the young man. Timothy is a true son in every sense that he was all that Paul wished him to be. The phrase carries with the sense of being united both in spirit and in purpose. Timothy had truly drunk of the Apostle Paul's spirit, passion, vision for the church. Paul and Timothy were united together in spirit. They were united in common purpose. At the heart of every successful organization, there's an overriding sense of purpose. The purpose is the fundamental reason or reasons why any organization exists. It defines what the organization does and what it wants to accomplish. The purpose of an organization serves as a guide, inspires, motivates people of the organization to achieve the God-given legacy. The purpose of an organization also develops within people a shared sense of ownership, responsibility to fulfill the reason for the organization's existence. There is a deep human yearning to make a difference in this world. People want to know that they have done something on this earth that has meaning. Now, people are looking for a cause or a purpose of existence. The best leaders are aware of this and are able to make use of this human longing for meaning and fulfillment. And they provide a dynamic purpose that will elevate the human spirit to achieve the impossible. Ernest Shackleton's transatlantic expedition of 1914 is one of the most incredible adventure stories of all time. Shackleton, in preparing for the epic adventure, knew the importance and lasting impact of creating a sense of purpose, and so he placed it in the classified section of a London newspaper, the following advertisement, which read, "Men wanted for hazardous journey. Small wages, bitter cold, long months of complete darkness, constant danger, safe return, doubtful, honor and recognition in case of success." Now you would wonder who on earth would volunteer for such an expedition. Yet amazingly, just over 1,000 men responded to the advertisement. Why is this? Well, Shackleton offered them a shared sense of purpose in their lives. He offered them a shared sense of ownership and responsibility for the success of the mission. A sense of purpose is the energy that invigorates the whole team to accomplish a goal. The sense of purpose creates comradeship that gets the best out of everyone to overcome insurmountable odds. This is especially seen when the goal of the expedition changed from traversing the Antarctic continent to the survival and rescue of each member of the team. Little did Shackleton know how prophetic the words of the advertisement would be. The expedition is filled with incredible tales of heroism and fortitude in the face of appalling hardship. They lost their ship in the middle of the Antarctic pack of ice at a time when there was no chance of contacting the outside world, let alone being rescued. Shackleton and his men were shipwrecked in one of the most forlorn regions of the world. Abandoning ship, he and his crew drifted on a sheet of ice pack for months, living on mere rations and seals. Then the ice pack opened up enough to give the castaways an opportunity to make a dash for the safety of Paulet Island. They launched their boats, tumbled into them, each grabbing an oar and heading off into the open sea. The men set out and began their voyage across the most tumultuous seas on the earth. The winds and currents were against them, forcing the group to change destination four times during their 5.5-day voyage. Finally, they reached Elephant Island. Shackleton realized that because of the remoteness of Elephant Island, he and his crew had little chance of rescue. Shackleton took one of the lifeboats and five men and set out for the whaling station on South Georgia Island, a distance of 1,330 kilometers. He returned 4 months later to rescue the remaining 22 men of his expedition. Their ordeal lasted 649 days, a far cry from Shackleton's estimated 120 days to traverse the South Pole. As seen in the saga of Shackleton and his men, there is nothing so powerful, nothing so effective as leaders and teams that are united together with a common purpose. The function of leadership is to engage those with whom the leader has partnered in a dynamic purpose. And someone once said that Jesus Christ placed in the Bible a similar advertisement to the one that Shackleton placed in the newspaper. And it read, "Disciples wanted for hazardous life experience of building my church, a little earthly reward, discouragement, constant attacks from the powers of darkness, seeing the fruits of your labors in this life doubtful, eternal honor and recognition after death." Timothy was one who responded to the hazardous life experience of the purpose of building the church. However, like many, he experienced a sense of deep disappointment along the way and needed encouragement and reminding of the great mission to which he had committed himself. Paul writes the epistle not only to encourage Timothy, but to encourage all who have made such a commitment to the common purpose of building the church. Being united in a common purpose means that we are all in this together, that we are going in the same direction, that we are here to help each other. The whole letter is about giving instructions to Christians to stand firm in their calling and not to forget our common purpose. Paul reminds us that the common purpose that binds the church together affects and changes the lives of people for the better and for all eternity. Standing orders of the day, 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 1 to 20. Let's begin by setting the scene. It's about 66 AD. Timothy's eyes had turned towards Rome. Word had no doubt reached him and all the world of the great fire of Rome in July AD 64, which had consumed 3/4 of the cities. Rumor has it that Nero himself had ordered the burning of the city in order that he might replace its decaying and unsightly streets with buildings and broad streets and stately buildings fitting his personal status as a god. Nero had gone as far as to use force to stop anyone from putting out the fire because it would interfere with his plans of grandeur for the city of Rome. Now, when the citizens of Rome returned to lay legal claim to their land, Nero refused to accept their legal claims. Now, this angered and outraged the populace of Rome. Nero then needed an escape goat. What better target than the unpopular Christians? He ordered that the guilt of the Christians be made so evident that it deserved the most severe punishment. He had them nailed to crosses, sewn in animal skins to dehydrate, and tied to posts and set upon by wild dogs, fed them to lions, and covered them in combustible material, and set alight as human torches to light up his own garden at night. At first, the persecution was limited to Rome, but it soon began to spread throughout all of the Roman Empire. Every Christian everywhere knew that their lives and well-beings were held together by the most slenderest thread, that at any moment they would be engulfed in the flames of persecution and destruction. The fire of Rome had ignited a fire of persecution that would rage out of control for more than 250 years. Timothy knew it was only a matter of time before the fires of persecution would engulf his flock at Ephesus, and that he would be engaged in every front in the fierce combat with the forces of darkness. What was he to do? The Apostle Paul, who we might say was the commanding officer of the Gentile church at that time, was well aware of what was happening. He saw the battle lines were drawn. He saw the difficulties that faced Timothy. And in this chapter, he relates to Timothy as his young lieutenant at Ephesus, what we call the standing orders of the day, from the commander-in-chief of the army of God, Jesus Christ. Standing orders is a military term. It describes an order given by the commander-in-chief of a military force, which cannot be changed without their personal sanction. The standing orders found in this chapter, in fact, in all scriptures, cannot be changed by man or by angel, no matter how fierce the fires of persecution burn, or how tensely the battle may wage, because they come from the church's great commander-in-chief, Jesus Christ. Section A, the Royal Command, chapter 1, verses 1 to 2. Paul begins, "Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, though Timothy is a very dear friend of Paul's," all this seems to be put aside in the opening greeting. The letter begins very formally, almost like an army dispatch. Paul writes as a man very conscious of his own commission. He writes as a man under orders, as an ambassador of a king, relaying an important letter to a trusted officer in the battlefield. Paul has no doubts concerning his authority to send such a dispatch that will enable Timothy to act in his stead at Ephesus. In fact, he traces his authority back to two sources. The first is by the command of God our Savior. Now the term God our Savior is new to Paul, as he usually spoke of Jesus our Savior. And what is more unusual is that the term has a pagan background to it and was used in imperial cult and emperor worship. The word Savior in the Greek is soter, and it was a title given to a person whom people revered and worshipped as a god who could save them. Now the cult seems to have its beginning back at the time of the ancient pharaohs. The Greeks gave the title to their healing god Asclepius. Julius Caesar installed the cult into the Roman way of life, and it was fostered by his successors as a means of ensuring stability and royalty to Caesar in the Roman Empire. Some of the more neurotic emperors, such as Nero, took their divinity seriously and insisted that people worship them and treat them as gods. Therefore, the title would have been frequently upon the lips of people of the world at that time. What Paul does, that he boldly takes the title of the one to whom it rightly belongs, God. For was it not God the Father who first desired our salvation and initiated it through his Son, Jesus Christ? The second source of Paul's authority is the Lord Jesus Christ, our hope. Now, Christianity entered a world devoid of hope. The Roman historian Tacitus wrote, "I am entering upon a period of history rich with disaster, gloomy with wars, and rent with sedition." It's no different today. The Irish Times on the 15th of August 2020 reported that over 50% of the normal population admitted to having suicide thoughts in the past 5 years. Yet, in this verse, Paul sets forth the remedy of all the ails that warn our decrepit Roman world and our world today: hope. It is the secret of the Christian's perseverance and victory, because it is the anchor of the soul that does not drag in the sands of uncertainty of Caesar's moods or any other political figure, but is fastened in the rock of Jesus Christ. Verse 2. Timothy was a son of a Greek father and a Jewish mother, and his name means one who honors God. It was a common name, probably given by the father to bring union of faith in the family. He was brought up in the Jewish faith by his mother and his grandmother. And Timothy was converted to Christianity by Paul on Paul's first missionary journey. And later Timothy joined Paul on the second missionary journey and remained Paul's companion until appointed as the overseer of the Ephesus church. Now, Ephesus was the capital of the Roman province of Asia, with a population of 300,000. The city contained one of the seven wonders of the ancient world, the Temple of Diana. A sexual license and occult were associated with the worship of Diana. Ephesus was also the bridge between Asia and Europe, thus making it a key strategic city for the spread of the gospel throughout the ancient world. Now, in spite of the many setbacks Paul had during his three-year ministry, had done a great work at Ephesus, and a large thriving church had been established that had such an impact upon the world that it says in Acts 19:10 that all of Asia had heard about the gospel of Jesus Christ. By the accounts written by Paul in other letters, Timothy was a quietly spoken person who was very sensitive to people. Yet he was well versed in the word of God and an excellent teacher and a loyal companion, whom Paul called a spiritual son. He was between the ages of 35 and 40 years of old when he received the first of two personally addressed letters to him. Following in the footsteps of a spiritual giant such as Paul was not easy for the young man like Timothy. And like all young pastors, he began to feel overwhelmed with the responsibility of his own inadequacy, dealing with the false teachers who slinked about like wolves, preying on the young Christians, and propagating a heresy that was a combination of Judaism and Gnosticism. And he started to begin to feel discouraged, if not a little bit depressed with the situation. He'd begun the race with great enthusiasm, but it appears now that he was in danger of abandoning it all. Paul writes the letter to Timothy both to encourage and to strengthen him in his ministry. Paul, when speaking of or to Timothy, cannot help but address him in the utmost affection. He calls him a true son of the faith. And it was the term that Paul, in later years of his life, used of young disciples such as Timothy and Titus, in whom he saw a genuine likeness of himself and of their character and faith. The phrase carries with it a common sense of purpose and underlining trust. Timothy had become all that Paul could have wished for him, to be in the faith. He had gone from being Paul's protege to being Paul's colleague. My prayer is that as we study 1 Timothy, that the likeness and character of the faith of Paul may be found in all of us, that we will move from being a protege of the faith to being a true son or daughter, a colleague. Upon such one comes three blessings from the Father, God, and Jesus Christ our Lord: grace, mercy, and peace. Now these words were a tremendous blessing to Timothy. The word grace describes God's divine favor overflowing like a fountain to sustain the saint. The word mercy describes God's continued help in times of stress, like gentle rain upon the dry and thirsty land. And peace is like the streams that issue from the fountain of grace. For the word speaks of the believer's present and continued experience with God. Section B. Timothy is to hold Ephesus, chapter 1, verses 3 to 11. In this passage, Timothy is encouraged to hold Ephesus from the outward forces of persecution and the internal forces of false doctrine that were both striving to destroy the church. Now, there's an old hymn that we used to sing with great gusto and enthusiasm. It's titled, "Hold the Fort, for I Am Coming." Now, the four lines of the hymn go like this: "Hold the fort, for I am coming, Jesus, signal still. Wave the answer back to heaven, by thy grace we will. Fierce and long the battle rage, but our hope is near. Onward comes our great commander, cheer my comrades, cheer." Now Philip Bliss wrote the hymn in 1870 after hearing David Whittle relate the following incident from the American Civil War, which was the battle at Altona. And General French, the leader of the Southern Confederate force with 6,000, had completely surrounded and summoned to the surrender of the Northern Union Army supply position at Altona, commanded by General Course. And now General Course refused and the battle began. The defenders were slowly driven into a small fort on the crest of a hill. Many had fallen and the result seemed that their situation was helpless. At that moment, an officer caught sight of a white signal flag far across the valley, some 20 miles in distance, upon a mountain. The signal was answered, and soon the message was waved back from mountain to mountain. And the message was, "Hold the fort, I am coming, W.T. Sherman." A cheer went up from every man, drew courage from the fact that General Sherman was coming to save them. And under murderous fire, they held the fort for 3 hours until the advance guard of Sherman's army came. The Southern Confederate force were forced then to retreat. The knowledge of General Sherman's coming to the aid of the defenders in this small fort sent up a rousing cheer of joy and triumph and fortitude. So too, the knowledge of our Savior coming sends a rousing cheer of joy, triumph, and fortitude throughout the letter. Christ is coming, and the forces of Satan must capitulate. Section 1, Stand Fast, chapter 1, verses 3 to 7, verses 3 to 4. In this passage, Paul's thoughts flow rather rapidly. Just as General Cross was urged by General Sherman to stand fast, so Paul urges Timothy to stand fast. As the supplies at Altona were the key to the success of General Sherman's campaign, so too was the church at Ephesus the key point in the church's strategy for world evangelism. Every church in every community is the key to God's desire for evangelism, and that church must hold or stand fast no matter the cost. Paul says, "I urge you," expressing the pressing necessity of Timothy to stay on at Ephesus, to continue the battle for truth against Satan. The word "remain" does give a slight hint that Timothy had thought of moving on. I mean, one could hardly blame him for such a thought. the city had what city being the stronghold of the demonic deity of deity, along with sexual immorality, had become the center of witchcraft and a waterhole of magic and other who practiced the black arts and astrology. Now Paul wrote in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 12 says, "For we are not fighting against people made of flesh and blood, but against evil workers, authorities of unseen world, against those mighty powers of darkness who rule this world, and against wicked spirits in heavenly realms." Paul reminds Timothy that he's a man of authority in Ephesus, and that he has a definite commission or charge. And the Greek word for charge is a military term, which literally means to pass a command from one to another. And Timothy's charge is not only to check the progress of false teachers, but to eliminate them altogether. And this is particularly brought out by the words, "no other doctrine." The words "no other" may be translated as "no different doctrine" or "not any other doctrine." By his choice of words, Paul is portraying the idea of something being out of harmony, such as a choir boy singing a different key to all other members in the choir. Then the word "some" does not mean that there are a few false teachers. Rather, it's Paul's way of referring to his opponents. Not only is Timothy to stop these false teachers, but also he's instructed not to allow himself and others to be drawn into their endless, tireless speculations of fables, myths, and genealogies. Both the Jews and the Gentiles were guilty in the ancient world of flittering away hours with endless discussions on myths and genealogies. The Gentile world was full of stories of gods marrying women and producing chosen families or people. Alexander the Great prefabricated his family's tree so he could trace it back to Achilles on one side and Hercules on the other. And the Jews were no better. The rabbis delighted in taking names from Genesis, 1 Chronicles, Ezra, or Nehemiah and fabricating stories about them and their pedigrees based on their myths. Paul tells Timothy that those who would rather be involved in myths and genealogies rather than godly edification, which is faith, are poor stewards. For the word edification, according to Greek scholars, refers to stewardship. They are therefore poor stewards of that which God has given them. Now John Bunyan said, "Some love the meat and some love to pick the bones." And Paul saw these false teachers as bone pickers. They would rather scrape the bone down to the marrow and serve it up to their listeners than the meat of the Word of God. These false teachers gave their listeners little nourishment from the Word of God and robbed people of their first love of Christ. Verse 5. Before continuing, Paul breaks off for a moment to show Timothy the character of his charge. And the word "command" is also a military word in the Greek, meaning something that's entrusted to a person. Paul says the purpose of the command or the aim of your charge is love, which is a practical demonstration of love one to another, caring for one another's needs and caring for each other. Paul sees love springing forth from three sources. Firstly, from a pure heart. And the word "pure" in the Greek here simply means clean as opposed to dirty. The word was used of corn that had its chaff completely removed. Later, it was used to describe an army that had been purified of all its undisciplined and cowardly soldiers until only the crack troops, the best troops, remained. So love comes from a heart that's cleaned of all cowardly self-ambition, or from a person whose heart is not only interested in bringing victory to themselves, but has removed all the chaff from their lives so that others may gain spiritual nourishment from them, as one would from an ear of corn. Secondly, a good conscience. And the word "conscience" here means to sit in judgment of oneself, to be free from the feeling of guilt. And though it's not stated, it's self-evident that Paul feels that such a thing could not take place without our minds being renewed by the work of the Holy Spirit, as stated in Romans chapter 12 and verse 2. Thirdly, he has sincere faith, which simply means faith without hypocrisy. It refers to one who is true to their faith. Now, if an archer has distrust for their weapon in time of battle, he will miss his mark. So it is with a hypocrite in the time of conflict. One's distrust in their faith will be shown, and they will miss the aim of their charge, which is love. Sincere faith is filled with enthusiasm that will step forward boldly, shooting the arrows with confidence into the aim and purpose for which it is charged, which is love. Verses 6 and 7. Paul now describes the sad result of false teachers who have lost the sight of their charge of love. He first describes them as some having strayed, having turned aside to idle talk. Now, the word strayed paints a picture of a traveler who will never reach their destination. They've taken the wrong path, even when they know they're on the wrong path, because there are no familiar signs, and the end of the road ends in a swamp of endless argumentation and reasoning. They make no effort to turn back. Why? Because their heads have been filled with idle talk. And the word idle talk here refers to the activity of a jester. That is, a professional joker or fool, a teller of funny stories who was later part of the medieval courts. Chancer, in his book, Parson's Tale, describes a jester as being one who spoke to mock people, who chatted like a mill and did not keep track of what he said. The second sad result of those that have lost their charge of love is that they have become just like those whom they've listened to, those idle talkers, those professional jesters or jokers or fools. Though they desired to become rabbis or doctors of the law, they were jesters of the law. They did not understand the underlying principles of the law and which they professed to expound, and their words were even meaningless to themselves. It's illegal to practice law if you're not qualified in the legal system of the land, because in doing so, such individuals expose the public to great risk, poor legal advice, representation, and deception. These false teachers were and are unqualified in the things of God, exposing those who listen to them to deception and the risk of losing their salvation. They knew nothing of the law or the word of God. Their character, they were charlatans and swindlers and confidence trickers who, by pretense and deception, take advantage of people. The purpose of the law, chapter 1, verses 8 to 11. Verse 8. The mention of the law leads Paul to discuss briefly the conditional purpose of the law. He states that the law is good. And the word good in the Greek, which not only refers to the excellence of intrinsic quality, but also to the outward beauty. Only if one uses it properly to restrain evil. He then says, if one uses it lawfully, which is a conditional if, showing that if the law is twisted or perverted for the benefit of few or to oppress the majority, then the beauty is tarnished and lost forever. Paul's point is that these false teachers were coming into the church and were tarnishing the beauty of the law and perverting and twisting it, its operation for their own benefit. Verses 9 and 10, we must bear in mind that Paul here is dealing with the one aspect of the law, that is restraining of evildoers. This is brought out particularly by the words righteous person. The word righteous in the Greek here is used in the widest sense and probably refers to a Christian. So it's interesting to note that Paul ends the general list of evil doers with the words, and if there are any other thing that is contrary to sound doctrine. Now, the word sound in the Greek here literally means health giving. Here it refers to being in a healthy spiritual state. The word is repeated 7 times throughout the pastoral epistles and becomes one of the central themes of the epistle. Paul borrows the medical term to give us a picture of false teachers. He says that these false teachers as being those who profess to be doctors with the ability to bring health and life, but are actual quacks, charlatans, who bring death and disease. Now, as you're aware, doctors wash their hands before an operation. But this was not always the case in the Middle Ages. Doctors would cut open the dead and examine them and see why they died. And without washing their hands, they would go and examine living patients in the obstetric wards. The resulting mortality rate amongst mothers-to-be was 10 to 35%. A Hungarian physician by the name of Egon Semmelweiser, whilst working in the Vienna General Hospital, noted that the rate was three times higher than the midwives' ward. And he deduced that washing of hands prior to examining patients was a factor for lowering this rate. The introduction of this changed the behavior on part of the doctors and led immediately to the drop of immortality rate. Semmelweiser is described as being the savior of mothers, as the simple theory of washing hands in chlorine lime solution reduced the mortality rate to below 1%. Paul sees these false teachers as being those who would handle the things of sin, corruption, and eternal death, like those doctors who did not wash their hands after handling the dead, and then go and transfer diseases of death to the living. Therefore, Paul says that the law is good because it restrains such false teachers from coming into the body of Christ and polluting it with sin, causing spiritual death of people. Verse 11. The words of Paul in this verse are filled with true enthusiasm, as his being is filled with intense rapture as he looks at the glorious work of the gospel as compared with his own feeble attempts of salvation. Now, he's like a person who's tested his own feeble powers to produce a work of art, now looks at the works of great artists such as Rembrandt and Monet, and comparing his own work to theirs, now not only appreciates and understands the effort and time it takes to produce such a wonder, but also is caught up in the rapture of the beauty of the masterpiece itself. Paul calls the gospel glorious, a word that does not carelessly fall from his lips. And Paul, as a man, has traveled the world. He's seen the glories of the Greeks and the Roman Empire. He's seen the great architecture, wonders of the world, the Temple of Diana at Ephesus, the great Colosseums at Rome, and the great sculptures at Athens, and all the glories of Caesar's court. But these things are nothing compared to the riches and glory of the gospel. It almost seems that Paul stops in mid-sentence and contemplates it. It's like that he's overwhelmed with the epiphany of the blessedness of God. It takes his breath away. He stops and continues. Oh, blessed God. Oh, the blessed God. The glorious, unique revelation of the gospel was possible not only because of the wisdom and power of God, but because of his very loving nature. Paul continues, the gospel, which was committed to my trust. There's no sense or even hint of egotism in the words of Paul. All self-praise, all self-recommendation is put aside as he contemplates the trust that has been given to him by God. Yet as unworthy as he is regarding this responsibility, he will not shrink back from it, as his commitment to teaching the gospel, which is blessed of God for good health and well-being of the saints of God. We've been all entrusted with the same responsibility. Section C, standing in the front line with the king. Chapter 1, verses 12 to 17. And verses 12 to 14. There's a story told of a Spartan wrestler at the Olympic Games who was offered a large bribe to let his opponent win, but he refused, and after a long and hard struggle, the Spartan won the match. And the one who offered him the bribe went to him and said, "What have you got out of this costly victory?" And the Spartan replied, "Well, I have won the privilege of standing in the front line with my king." His reward was to fight side by side with his king. Paul also sees himself as one that's who's earned the great privilege of fighting side by side with King Jesus. So that we might attain the same goal, he proceeds to tell us how this happened. Firstly, because Christ has empowered him. And in verse 12, Paul says, "Who has enabled me?" And the word "enabled" in the Greek carries the idea of receiving strength from another, both in the past and a continued reality. Paul sees Christ as his strength imparted. Secondly, because he obtained mercy, verse 13. Paul gives us a brief summary of his misguided Christian career. He says first he was a blasphemer of the church, meaning that he flung hot and angry words of insult against the church. And not content with that, he became a persecutor, persecuting and hounding the church to the full extent of the law. And still not content with that, he became an insolent person. And the word insolent in the Greek is a terrible word that describes a person who for the sheer joy of it inflicts pain. The word in the Greek signifies a violent man, in short, a thoroughly objectionable character. Aristotle defined it to mean to hurt and to grieve people in such a way that shame comes to that man who is hurt and grieved, and not so that the person who inflicts the hurt and injures may gain anything, but simply that he may delight in his own cruelty and in the suffering of the other person. But Paul says, but I obtained mercy. I did it ignorantly and in unbelief. Paul does not claim that he is without guilt, but that during his campaign of aggression against the church, he really thought he was doing God a favor. Therefore, he did not become the object of God's wrath, even though he deserved it. Rather, he became an object of God's pity and compassion and obtained mercy. Paul says in verse 14 that he received grace. Paul describes the grace as exceedingly abundant, meaning that it was more than met his needs, as it overflowed the usual channels, bringing with it a lavishness of undeserved blessing. So Paul encourages us to continue our struggle in the faith, because we have, like him, been empowered by Christ for the conflict, and also we have received both grace and mercy. And in doing this, as did Paul, we shall obtain our goal of fighting alongside Jesus Christ in the great spiritual battles. Verse 15, Paul begins with the words, "This is a faithful saying," meaning that is reliable or solid statement, like a giant immovable granite rock, that Christ came to save sinners. And Paul ends the verse with this phrase, "of whom I am chief." Now, it's significant that Paul makes this statement not as a new believer, but after he's walked with God for over 25 years. And it's certainly a difficult phrase to translate. And it's further complicated because the word chief applies not to time, but to degree. Paul is chief, not merely the first of sinners. Now, most commentators believe that Paul is not comparing himself with others, but as he sees himself before God, the word expresses the true cry of the conscience when ceasing to compare itself with others, sees itself in the sight of God. We must understand that this is not an unhealthy boasting upon sin's experience here, nor is it boasting of sin in the past, which is equally as dangerous. Rather, it was Paul's way of dealing firstly with pride, and secondly, a way of fanning the flames of gratitude to having God in his life. You know, the closer a person walks with God, the more they are aware of the depths of their sinful nature, which in turn drives them to a deeper appreciation of the grace of God. C.S. Lewis says these words, "When a man is getting better, he understands more and more clearly the evil that is still in him. When a man is getting worse, he understands his own badness less and less." John Newton, who wrote the hymn Amazing Grace, is amongst the greatest preachers and hymn writers of the church that has ever known. Before he was saved, he was a slave trader and sank to the depths a man could go in such an occupation. After his conversion, he had a sign fixed to his mantelpiece of his study, and it was from Deuteronomy chapter 15, verse 15, and said these words, "You shall remember that you were a slave in the land of Egypt, and the Lord your God redeemed you." Whenever John Newton began to be filled with pride of his achievements, he would look at that sign, and it would bring him back, would bring back memories of his past life, of how he hurt God and others. Yet it didn't leave him groveling in the dust. Rather, it fanned the flames of gratitude in his life. For once he'd been a slave trader, but now he was now a fisher of men. Once he had no regard for human life, but now he held it in the utmost regard because Christ had died for all humanity. When we remember our sins, let us do it in such a way that it deals effectively with the sin of pride in our lives, whilst at the same time fanning the flames of gratitude for God's great mercy upon our lives, urging us on to greater efforts in God. Verses 16 and 17. Paul tells us why he had received mercy. Firstly, that Christ may show Paul as an excellent example of Christ's long-suffering to a sinner who deserves his wrath, but instead received his mercy. Secondly, that Paul might be a pattern for others to find eternal life. And the word pattern in the Greek here means an outline of an artist's sketch. What Paul is saying is that Christ is like a great artist who used Paul's life as a simple outline sketch of Christ's glorious mercy. And as others look upon Paul's life and relate to that sketch, they will find eternal life in Christ. And so they in turn become the colors that Christ uses to complete the painting that he began. Each one of us become the glorious colors of a great canvas which displays Christ's mercy. And on that day when Christ comes for the church, that canvas will be finished. And what began as an outline sketch of the early church will be a beautiful painting showing Jesus Christ's mercy to undeserved sinners. It's no wonder that Paul ends this passage in verse 17 with a grateful expression of worship to God, as he describes God as the one and only supreme King who governs all the ages from creation of the world to the end of time, and one because he, God, is immortal, who is without decay and is all-knowing. The Scottish preacher and hymn writer, Walter Smith, who was moved by these words of Paul, that a being who is eternal, who is immortal, could save undeserving sinners like us, sat down in 1867 and penned one of the greatest Christian hymns titled Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise. The hymn has six stanzas compiled of 23 different passages of Scripture focusing on the Creator of the universe, the invisible God whose visible works in nature testify to his glory and majesty. The longer we walk with the Lord, the more we appreciate the full significance of Paul's words in this passage. Section D, Fight a Good Campaign, chapter 1, verses 18 to 20, verses 18 to 99. Paul again uses the military term with the word charge. In the English, conveys a sense of urgency to Timothy's call. Paul continues to show Timothy quite clearly that the charge that was given to Timothy is not out of harmony with the prophecies which were given over him and that have led him to his present position. Although we are not told the contents of the prophecy, it's obvious from the passage that they revealed special spiritual gifts that were given to Timothy to ensure his success at Ephesus. There's a story told of Doug Newberg, a professor of sports psychology, and in his research he found that world-class performers who lost their edge could be rejuvenated to move ahead with a sense of purpose and commitment if they could revisit their dreams. And one day he was called to a hospital to find a surgeon who had hit an emotional wall and could not move past it. The heart surgeon had performed 401 successful operations. However, patient 402 had died on the operating theater. And this had such an emotional impact on the surgeon that he could not move past it. And what was worse was patient 403 was waiting to be operated on. The conversation between surgeon and Newberg began uncomfortably. Newberg kept nudging the surgeon, and then he asked the surgeon this question: what will it take to regain your dream? The question seemed to open a door in the surgeon's past. The surgeon remembered at the age of six coming home and standing in the doorway watching his grandfather have a massive heart attack and dying. The boy felt absolutely helpless. He vowed that he would prepare himself so that he would never again feel that way. He would never again stand there unable to do anything. Remembering his vow and vision energized the great surgeon, and he went back into the theater and performed the operation. And what is particularly interesting is how the surgeon explains the 403rd operation. He said he felt like he had an out-of-body experience. He could see his hands tying sutures. He could see them flying nimbly across the patient. Yet it did not feel like his own. He was so energized with the commitment. In leadership, we are constantly told that when facing great setbacks and obstacles, we need to revisit our vision. Why? It is because every time we look upon our vision, there is an exchange of strength that rejuvenates us to carry on. Just so, there is a great power in revisiting the fulfillment of prophetic words over our lives. Remembering the fulfillment thus far of these prophetic words over Timothy's life would have acted like a stimulus factor in Timothy's life. Paul reminds Timothy of these prophecies that he might again call forth the qualities of a man of God to which Timothy had been called. Recalling what God had already accomplished in our lives can revitalize us to continue on in the productive service for God. Paul continues the military language, wage a good warfare. As he assures the young lieutenant that the series of prophecies confirming his calling will provide him with inspiration for the conflict that lies ahead. It's interesting to note that the word warfare in the Greek is the word for campaign, which shows that a Christian has not entered into a one-day conflict, but one that lasts a lifetime. In waging of this war, Timothy is told to clutch tight on two weapons, faith and good conscience, without which he cannot win the campaign. Verses 19b to verse 20. Paul suddenly moves from the Christian conflict to the disappointing picture of a shipwrecked life. On April 10, 1912, the Titanic left her berth at the harbour of Southampton, England. This was her maiden voyage, and she carried with her 2,228 passengers and crew. Most of the passengers had paid thousands of dollars to sail on this great luxury liner. 4 days into the voyage, on April 14, 1912, a severe ice warning was received in the area through which the Titanic was sailing. Now, these warnings were ignored. The Titanic maintained her course for New York. At 11:40 p.m., the Titanic struck an iceberg on the starboard side of her bow. She began to take on water at an alarming rate, and within 3 hours, the Titanic and 1,523 of her passengers and crew were at the bottom of the Atlantic Ocean. Only 705 of the original 2,228 persons survived the great shipwreck. Since 1912, people have tried to figure out what happened to bring the demise of the ship. Most people agree that the tragedy was a mixture of many things, including negligence, apathy, greed, pride, and incompetence. In other words, the tragedy could have been avoided had proper steps been taken by the captain and the crew of the Titanic. But since those steps were not taken, a tragic loss of life occurred on that cold night in the North Atlantic Ocean. Now, facts behind great shipwrecks of history make a fascinating study. But did you know that not all shipwrecks happen at sea? It's true, most shipwrecks occur on dry land. They occur in life. They occur when believers let go of the great spiritual truths of the gospel. A Christian is not only called to be a good soldier, they are called to be a good sailor. A good sailor would not cast overboard the ship's rudder, nor would he cast overboard the baluster. Then the baluster is anything heavy carried by a ship to give it stability whilst sailing. Rejecting any one of these two things, let alone both, would make the ship unmanageable and certainly lead to shipwreck. A good conscience is like a rudder. It obeys the directions of the Holy Spirit and the Word of God. And faith is like the baluster. It adds stability to our lives. Paul likens Hymenaeus and Alexander to foolish sailors who have cast overboard the rudder of good conscience and the baluster of faith in Jesus Christ, and so made shipwrecks of their lives. Because of their actions, Paul says that he's delivered them unto Satan, so that they should learn not to blaspheme. It's not clear what Paul meant when he said he delivered them over to Satan. Some have thought it means that they were reduced to the state of a heathen and inflicted with body diseases. But this seems really out of context with the passage. Most commentators see it as a remedial action that puts a person outside of the protection of the body of Christ to the point where the body is subject to the attacks of Satan, who inflicts them with all sorts of diseases and mental harassment. But their soul is not destroyed. And yet still, when they see the error of their ways and repent, these diseases and demonic attacks will leave them immediately, and they will be restored back into the fold. In the midst of this dark portrait of disappointment of life, a light of hope streams across the canvas. All is not lost. Even shipwrecked souls who have been swept off course by the winds of false doctrine can be saved in this verse. Paul has brought together two images that we know well. The parable of Jesus searching for the lost sheep in Luke's gospel, and the event of Jesus walking on the water in the midst of the storm in John's gospel chapter 6, coming to rescue the disciples. Our religion is a religion of hope. Even a shipwrecked soul, the backslider, who once knew the closeness of the Master's presence, may again be redeemed. Conclusion. At the height of the Cold War, John F. Kennedy, at his inaugural address in Washington, D.C., 20th of January, 1961, said these words: "Let every nation know, whether it wishes us well or ill, that we shall pay any price, bear any burden, meet any hardship, support any friend, oppose any foe, to assure the survival and success of liberty." The words ring with a sense of urgency, defiance, and victory. A country that's engaged in war must have a strategy of urgency, defiance, and victory. Paul saw the Christian life as a battleground, and in this letter and in his other letters to the church, Paul uses terms of warfare, weapons, shipwrecks, battles, and victory. Paul ends this section of the letter with a tone of urgency and defiance and victory. Timothy has been giving the standing orders of the day, which came to him through prophecy, and they will not change. Timothy is to fight a good fight, to hold fast the gospel of grace at Ephesus. We too, in the place that where we stand and worship God, have been given the same standing orders. Timothy and our resolution is to remain strong. We shall pay any price, bear any burden, meet any hardship, support any friend, oppose any foe for the advancement of the gospel in our local community, nation, and entire world. The grace that has turned our lives around and can turn around the lives of all who hear it is a truth which is worth fighting for. Amen.